Aditya Mehra from Max Planck Institute for Gravitational Physics, telling us about flat space holography. Over to you, Aditya.
Hi, everyone. So my name is Aditya Mehra. So today I will be speaking about flat space holography. And thank you, organizers, for letting me give a talk, like give actually a lecture. That is really nice. So I have one just small thing, like, so in between there will be a small, like, for example, like I will give you some small questions so that like in like after the lectures or something, you can try it at home also, in between, like few things, not that much, so that there will be a practice for you. And also like, it will be good that you also get involved in the things which I'm trying to like explain to you. So yeah, let's start. So we start with the introduction. So let's do this. Yeah. So we know that the physics in all is all about length scales, and most theories that we use to describe nature are effective theories, including the spectacular successful standard model of particle physics. So effective theories are often formulated by going to a certain subsector of a higher theory. Hence, often there is a lot to be learned by focusing on these subsectors. So one of the various obvious examples that comes to mind in this regard is the non-relativistic sector of relativistic theories. So Galilean physics is obtained from the relativistic physics by taking C tends to infinity. Like if you take Poincaré algebra and take this C tends to infinity, you get the Galilean algebra. Similarly, it depends on the field theories. So various counterintuitive things happens in this singular limit. So just let me know if I'm going fast or slow, or just let me know. So I can just slow my pace. So here the light cone open up the space-time metric degenerate. Oh, sorry, it's like. So the light cone opens up, the space-time metric degenerates, and the Riemannian structure is lost. New mathematical structure emerges that are the space-time manifold becomes what we call as the Newton-Cartan manifold. So if you take the non-relativistic limit on the Einstein-Hilbert axiom, what you get basically is the Newton-Cartan action, or basically Newton-Cartan theory out of it. So one could ask if similar new structures may emerge when one takes C tends to zero instead of infinity. This limit has been dubbed the Carolian limit, or basically the ultra-relativistic limit. This defines a contraction, as I have told you, similarly as that for the Galilean case, of the Poincaré group, and the group we call as the Carolian group. So first, if you take C tends to infinity limit, you get what is known as the Galilean limit. But if you take C tends to zero limit, you get the ultra relativistic, or the known as the Carolian limit. Now, holographic due to flat space. It is more than 20 years since the advent of the famed ADS-CFT correspondence, which has given a firm footing to the idea of holography. Yeah. So this has opened up an avenue of studying quantum gravity by looking at quantum field theories and vice versa. So our physical world is, however, clearly not ADS, as we know. For many applications, especially astronomical ones, the universe can be well approximated by an asymptotically flat spacetime. Asymptotically means that you are going to a very large distance, and from there your Lorentzian manifold becomes Minkowski. So it is thus of great importance to extend the notion of holography from its original setting in asymptotically ADS spacetimes to flat backgrounds. So a natural way to construct a holographic UFT for a general gravitational theory is to consider the symmetric structure at the boundary of the spacetime in which gravitational theory lives. These symmetries at the boundary are formally given by what we call as the asymptotic symmetric group, which is the ASG in short. and by its associated algebra. Just to give a definition, what is ASG in general? So in mathematical terms, given a set of boundary conditions, so ASG is basically are those which are the group of all allowed diffeomorphisms divided by the group of trivial diffeomorphisms. Allowed diffeomorphisms are the those which generates a metric consistent with given boundary conditions from an allowed metric. Whereas your trivial diffeomorphisms are those where the conserved charges are zero. So you have to divide them and then you get the generators out. So one can then propose that the dual field theory lives on the asymptotic boundary of the space-time and inherits the symmetry of the ASG. This analysis of AFG, we will see into the lecture also about this. So this analysis of the ASG of ADS3, for example, leads to two copies of the Virasoro algebra, which are, of course, the symmetry of the 2D CFT. So in light of that, what we will do, the content of this lecture will be as follows. So first, basically in the today's lecture, what I will do is I will give a brief review on the conformal field theories. And we'll also tell you about the ADS spacetime on the NTD sitter spacetime. Tomorrow's lecture will be basically on the ADS CFT correspondence and the Bondi-Michener-Sark group, which is the BMS, which is the another lecture. And this will be your the gravity side, and then we will move on to the boundary side, which is the Galilean and the Carolean conformal group. Finally, what we will do is we will do the comparison of the quantities between the boundary and the bulk. And if I have time, like in the end, so I will also explain you about these field theories in higher dimensions and also explain about one of the field theories of the Carolean algebra, like an example for it. Like these field theories have this symmetry. But before going into that, let us look at one last thing. So there has been a resurgence in the study of physics in flat spacetimes, initiated by Strominger and his collaborators. So one of the intriguing picture has emerged linking asymptotic symmetries with soft theorems in asymptotically flat spacetimes and to memory effects. So whoever is interested here, can I point out to this paper where it is by Strominger. So it is very nice where he explained this triangle, where at one point you have the asymptotic symmetry, at the other end you have the soft theorems, and finally you have the memory effect. And each is connected to each other by the Fourier transform, vacuum transitions, and Ward identities. So today in this lecture, basically we will focus on the asymptotic symmetries. But there is also these people who works like in soft theorems, and the memory effect. Basically, the memory effect is linked to the gravitational wave. Your soft theorems is linked to the massless external particles where you take the energy to zero. And asymptotic symmetries is related to BMS and all what we will do in these lectures.
Hello?
Yeah. Sorry.
What is this infrared triangle? You have written this.
So infrared triangle is nothing. Infrared triangle is like a connection between these. Like first these theories were separate and Strominger then came up with that. Each of the point in this triangle is related to each other. That's it. Like many people have developed techniques to connect soft theorem with asymptotic symmetries and asymptotic with the memory effect, or the memory effect with the soft theorem. And then he comes within triangle where he writes how one is related to each other through which process. So that is like the Fourier transform, vacuum transition and all. So if you want to look at these things, you can look at this paper by him, and it's really nice. Like he has given a good description about that. So if you can note this down, you can note down. So I will wait for two minutes or something. Should I move on?
Yeah, okay. Means why this infrared means is connected to this kind of means I'm not having
no, infrared is that you have the infrared dynamics here. So basically, you know what is infrared cutoff in basically this is like where you have the minimum, it's just a name, like you have the infrared dynamics, you have the temperature involved or something. I'm not an expert in this basically.
Can I just say one thing? I mean, infrared comes here because we are looking at low energy scale. So
low energy, that is true. Mm-hmm. And the maximum.
For example, when we are looking at soft theorem, it is the statement of low energy in the S matrix theorem.
Yes.
And from there, it derives the name infrared. And basically, here the three apparently distinct theories like memory effect, soft theorems, asymptotic symmetries are being connected to each other by some processes, as Aditya was describing.
Yes. Thank you so much, Arna.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So if you draw inspiration from ADS-CFT, holography in asymptotically flat space-time should involve the infinite dimensional symmetric algebras and the putative duals theory should be a non-gravitational QFTs living on the null boundaries and invariant under the infinite extended VMS algebra. Putative means like it is assumed, or we will see this, what you mean by putative in the coming lectures. So a natural avenue to explore flat holography is to investigate the singular limit where the bulk theory goes from ADS to flat space. So we will show that this leads to an ultra-relativistic contraction or the Carolean of the boundary CFT. So these conformal version of Carolean theories are putative dual to flat space. So what we will see in this lecture is that the Carolean conformal symmetries is equivalent to its BMS symmetry. It's isomorphic. So BMS in one higher dimension is isomorphic to Carolean conformal symmetries in one lower dimension. Similar to what you have in ADS-CFT.
Is the statement true for all dimensions? Is that the claim? Because I thought there is some confusion regarding BMS symmetries.
Yes. In so different... it is true till, for example, you have BMS 3 and CCA 2, and okay. BMS 4 and CCA 3. And there is some stuff which I will also explain in the end about the BMS 5 and CCA 4.
I see. Okay.
Yeah. That is for the higher dimension. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Hello. So I have a question. So you have a similar correspondence for this another limit of this C. I mean this Galilean.
Yes. We have.
But this is not, that is not this BMS symmetry, right?
For the two dimension, you have BMS 3 and GCA or CCA 2. Because in two dimension, GCA and CCA are isomorphic to each other.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
There is someone, Rita. Yeah,
hello. Can you hear me?
Hi.
Yeah, so this I don't know completely, that's why I'm asking. So this BMS group, as far as I remember, is super translation and Viras cross Virasoro that have been shown. Super rotation, has it also been shown? Means so this Carolean conformal symmetry, this would probably then give you what should be the BMS or the maximum.
That is true. We will see in the coming lecture about that. Yeah, this is just an introduction, but you will see in the coming lecture that you get the super translation.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Hi. Okay. BMS D plus one is the symmetry of D plus one Minkowski or D Minkowski or?
No. This is D plus one, like D plus one Minkowski. Yeah.
Because so it's D plus one Minkowski.
Yeah. Thank you. One higher dimension to that of CC. Okay. or I must be wrong. I don't know. I have to say. Yeah.
Anish, you have a question?
Yes, yes. So when you say BMS, you're only talking about without the only super translation semi direct Lorentz, or are you talking about extended slash diffeomorphisms also?
I'm talking about the extended, the full BMS.
So extended as in like only Virasoro, not the diffeomorphisms of type, right? Sorry.
Like for example, you have all, like, because BMS is an infinite dimensional algebra, so it includes everything, right?
Right. No, I'm saying the extension, there are two possibilities, right? One is the Virasoro and the other is all smooth diffeomorphisms of the sphere, the generalized BMS or the extended BMS, which is this. So what is the duality here?
So this is, I think, with the Virasoro, basically. The Virasoro. Yeah.
I see. Okay.
Should I move forward? So yeah, moving on to our first conformal field theory. So there are the theories that are without scales or whose dimensionful parameters are classically scale invariant. A simple example is the scalar field with one quartic interaction, as you can see in equation one. It works, where it is, yeah, here. So as we see, the action is invariant if we simultaneously rescale the space-time coordinates and the field with a specific weight. As you can see, equation two. So if you take delta equal to one, this is the scale dimension of the field. So the same theory would not be invariant if we had a mass term, as other may check easily. Another example is Yang-Mills coupled to massless fermion or scalars. In all these theories, scale invariance is broken by quantum corrections. So what is a conformal group? Invariance under scale transformation typically implies invariance under the bigger group of conformal transformation, which is not truly true, but still. Conformal transformation in d-dimensional spacetime is a change of coordinate that rescales line element as these. For the dilatation, as you can see, if you x goes to, here it is, here, x mu goes to lambda mu, where you have dx square goes as lambda square, and ct as this, where omega is your arbitrary function. So the conformal transformation, what it does, it rescale lengths but preserves the angle between the vectors. So at an infinitesimal level, when you take x mu prime goes to x mu plus v mu, some function, where omega is 1 plus, bigger omega is 1 plus omega by 2. So you can easily derive the condition 5 by using the metric. So taking the trace of this, we obtain something as d, which is d is the dimension, omega equal to 2 del of v. And substituting it in equation 5. What we obtain an equation which is identifying the conformal transformation at the infinitesimal level. It is given by equation 6. These are the basics I'm just trying to give so that, yeah. So it is known that in two dimension, I think you already have seen in two dimension in the previous some of the lectures, that there are infinite solutions of this equation and the conformal group is infinite dimension. But for d greater than 2, the number of solutions is smaller and is given by at most quadratic functions of v mu. So the general solution of that equation indeed given by, if you take the variation of x mu, so first we'll give you the translation. Here it is. Yeah. So this is the translation. This factor will give rise to your Lorentz transformation, J mu nu. Lambda x mu will give you the scale transformation. And K, and this fact, the weird looking thing, will give you the special conformal transformation. So as seen from above, in total, we have d plus 1 into d plus 2 by 2 generators. So for example, in 4 dimension, if you take, you will have in total 15 generators. So in fact, one can check that this group is isomorphic to SOD, 2. So this you can see by yourself. For example, this is very easy. So you have to basically rewrite your generators in terms of J's, like the other J's of the SOD, 2. And there you can find, like, you can write it as SOD, 2. Yeah. So there is an extra discrete symmetries that act as conformal transformation, which we call as the inversion. So adding that, we obtain the full conformal group, which we call as the O, 2, D. D is the dimension. Okay. So once we have the conformal group, next we will write down the conformal algebra. So this is the whole conformal algebra. Here you have the basic Lorentz transformation. So up the first two is the Poincaré algebra, and these rest is the addition to the conformal algebra, which you have by using the commutation between the special conformal and dilatation. So this was for the bosonic part. Small note for the supersymmetric. In the presence of supersymmetry, the conformal group is enhanced to a supergroup obtained by, so you have the SO2, D. If you add the supercharges and the R symmetry and plus the conformal supercharges, you get the super conformal algebra. So your QA are basically the charges which is linked to these fermionic generators, and R symmetries are the one which rotates them among themselves. And to close the algebra, you should have the conformal supercharge. Otherwise, your algebra will not close. So this was about the classical conformal field theories or the algebra. Now we will move on to the conformal QFTs. So in a quantum theory, conformal invariance is broken by the introduction of renormalization scale. So in pure Yang-Mills, which is classically scale invariant, the gauge coupling runs with the energy scale. As you know, a dimensionful parameter is introduced by dimensional transportations. And the quantum stress energy tensor is not traceless anymore. Basically, tracelessness is linked to the conservation of scale transformation. So it should, as you can see, if you go to the quantum version of this theory, so your T mu is proportional to beta, which is the beta function, and F square alpha beta is basically for the Yang-Mills. So in a more general theory, with gauge fields, fermions, and scalars, all dimensionless coupling runs with the energy scales. So in the following, we will denote generically with G, the set of coupling of the theory. The classical dimension which we have, which is the D of the theory, will then be corrected by the anomalous dimension, which is you have this gamma, and gamma is given by this, where your Z, this Z. So Z is basically a function or a constant which you pick up when you try to renormalize the theory. So for this thing, if someone is interested, I recommend to read all the 3 R's of the quantum field theory, which is the regularization, renormalization, and the renormalization group. So one way to obtain the conformal invariant quantum field theories are the finite theories. So suppose we have a theory with no divergence at all. So in these theories, your beta function is 0 and there is no RG flow. So the theory is conformal also at the quantum level. A standard example of this is the n=4 supersymmetric Yang-Mills theory. This theory has non-abelian gauge field, 4 Weyl fermions, and 6 scalar fields. So for this theory, the one loop beta function is given by equation 13. Where your C are basically your Casimirs related to each of the fields. So if you just remove this, the beta function minus G cube, but you get for the QCD or the QED, I think so. Yeah, where C is the Casimir of the representation of the gauge field, fermions, and scalars. Since all the field transform in the adjoint representation, all the Casimirs are equal, and we have the beta function in one loop equal to zero. But if you have in the fundamental representation, I think there will be some difference. But yeah, this is for the, if all are in the adjoint representation. It all depends on the representation which you are choosing. So it can be checked that the theory is finite at three loops, and it is believed to be finite at all orders. So if people are interested, so I recommend them to basically look at the expression 16 by yourself, try to calculate. If someone is interested, and try to see why this is zero for the n equal to 4 supersymmetry. Yeah. Till here, do you have any question or it's fine? I will stop, like if I'm going so fast or something.
Hello.
Yeah.
So in the earlier where you showed the beta function vanishing, there only the gauge field was in the adjoint representation, or all of them were in the adjoint?
No, in this, the all are present.
Okay.
Because this is n equal to 4 supersymmetric. So you have fermions, dilatons, gauge field, and everything.
So it means typically it would be like the fermions are in some fundamental or anti-fundamental.
If you are considering QCD or QED.
Okay.
Then over there you have the fundamental representation. That's why there the beta function is not zero.
Okay. So is there a way to like determine which representation in a given theory your matter, what should be?
Basically, your QCD, QED, I don't think so. They have a beta function equal to zero. This is a special case, and only n equal to 4 supersymmetric theory has this. Yang ones.
Thank you.
So just one question. The number of scalars that if you go to the next slide, so there I guess the number of scalars is 6, right?
Yeah.
And that 6 lives in the R representation group, meaning R symmetry group, right?
Mm-hmm.
That is SO4.
This is SO6.
SO6, okay. Okay, so, SU4, I see.
Yeah, SU4.
So that is not the representation you're talking about, this fundamental or adjoint representation. You're talking about the representation of the gauge field.
Yes. It's different, yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Susie. All right. So moving forward, this was a small recap of the conformal field theories. So till now, I have told you a small introduction why we are really interested in flat space holography, and give you the picture of the boundary side, which we have the CFTs. Now we will move on to the ADS, the bulk side of the theory. So in long, it is known as anti-De Sitter space. So we will now introduce the gravitational side of the story. So let us take, for example, the ADS-5. So ADS-5, as we know, is the maximally symmetric solution of the Einstein equation in 5 dimension with cosmological constant. So as you can see, even from the Hilbert-Einstein action, which is given by equation 15, you will get the equation of motion as r mu nu minus g mu nu r by 2. With a negative cosmological constant, where your Ricci tensor is 5/3 and r mu nu is λ/3 g mu. So this equation basically tells us that the solution is in Einstein space. So if we further require that r mu nu tau, which is the Riemannian tensor, should be given by this. So we have a maximally symmetric space. In short, it is also known as MSS. So it all depends on the signs which you are taking. For example, if you are taking an Euclidean sign, so your MSS with lambda greater than zero is a sphere. for radius 5, S5, sorry, not for radius 5, I'm sorry, for the maximal symmetric space with SO6. And if you take lambda less than 0, you have a hyperboloid with isometry ISO SO 1, 5. Similarly, if you take the similar thing for the Minkowski sign with lambda greater than 0, you get the D-sitter space, which is DS5. And for lambda less than 0, you have the anti-D-sitter set, which we will be studying in these few slides, the ADS5. So all these spaces can be realized as a set of solutions of a quadratic equation in a six-dimensional flat space with suitable signature, which is the real R, D, 6 minus D. So let us focus on ADS5. So if you define it as a set of solutions of, as it is given in equation 17, where R is your radius of the ADS, and this R is related to the cosmological constant by this equation 1 by R squared equal to minus lambda by 12. So in a flat space-time with line element given by equation 18. So as you can see, you have two minuses and plus, all the direction of the plus are the four, the other. So it is obvious from the definition, as you can see from above, that the isometric group is over 2, 4, identical to the conformal group in four dimensions. So now there are many set of coordinates you can define on the ADS. So one of them is given by equation 19. Yeah. And if you take this coordinate and put it in equation 18, what you get is equation 20, as you can see, where omega 3 is the line element of the three sphere. So it is easy to verify that rho belongs to the r plus direction and the tau is limited to 0 to 2 pi covers the Minkowski hyperboloid exactly once. So what we call these are the global coordinates. There are second set of coordinates that is given by x0 and x5. Given by these equation. I don't know, I didn't give the name. Yeah, equation 21. So as you can see here, you have x0 given by this expression, x5 by rut, and x1, 2, 3 are the spatial direction. And r is the radius of the ADS. So x4, it is also given by this. So with u greater than 0, it is the fifth coordinate, which brings the metric to the form equation 22. So as you can see, u is basically kind of a scale factor or a warp factor. And it is basically wrapping the 4D Minkowski spacetime. So these coordinates are known as the Poincaré coordinates because you have a section of a 4D Minkowski spacetime in like there. So the 4D spacetime is foliated over u, which runs from 0 to infinity. The plane u equal to infinity is referred to as the boundary of the ADS5. So to note here is, however, that u tends to infinity, the metric ds square blows up, as you can see from above, from 22. So mathematically, what you have, u equal to infinity is the conformal boundary. So one way basically to see is that you have to divide it ds square by u square. If you does that, so you will get the new metric, ds square tilde, for example, will be equal to ds square by u square in the limit u tends to infinity, which is again, you see the conformal metric. Okay. So there are other form of the metric in the Poincaré coordinates that are commonly used. So they all differ by a redefinition of the u. For example, with u equal to 1 by z, or equal to e to the power r, we have equation which is given by 23, as you can see. So ds square, it is the same thing, just you are doing the redefinition of 22, but your Minkowski part is the same everywhere. It's just the redefinition everywhere. And the boundary, now it is at z equal to 0 and r equal to infinity. So there are other coordinates also of the ADS, but what is relevant in our lecture will be only the global coordinates and the Poincare coordinates. So yeah, do you have any question? Yeah, so like I have finished my lectures of today. So if you have any questions, then we can now, we have 20 minutes, so we can talk. And for tomorrow, I will talk about the large end limit of the case theories and the ADS-CFT correspondence. So we have sufficient time to discuss. No question.
Aditya, like I mean, the lecture was supposed to be for 1.5 hours.
Yeah, no, I can go. I can go, but I'm just waiting if people have.
Okay. Fine.
Yeah. I'm just waiting.
Yeah, if people do you guys have any questions? Like, if not, maybe we can proceed for some more time and then like we can break maybe.
Yeah.
Looks like.
Sure. Then I can go through. Yeah. Yeah. Let me know if the pace was right or it was fast or something. So yeah. Because it was
to the audience, like if you feel the pace was all right, please give a thumbs up. Like.
Yeah. Otherwise, I can slow down. Pace is good. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
I mean, if you don't find the pace, okay, please do say.
Like, yeah. So I will wait just for 2-3 minutes and then I will go. Oh, I still have a lot of time. Sorry.
Yeah, it's supposed you. I actually have close to 45 minutes.
Okay, no worries. Then I can go through. Yeah. Yeah. Just wait for 2 minutes, and then I will then go. By the time if people have some questions they can ask, then I can move forward.
One question.
Sure.
So how is the stress tensor related to the, means trace of the stress tensor related to the beta function? This is just a naive question.
Ah, okay. So, here, right? The equation 11. So you want like how?
Yeah, okay. So T mu beta G. If 2 alpha beta is your gauge field strength.
Yeah, this is for the pure Young noise. Yes. Okay. So basically what you do, hello?
Yes.
Ah, so basically what you do is you take your coupling constant and then you shift it via the beta function. So you take, can I write here? Yeah, I can write down there. Okay, 2 minutes. Yeah, I can write here, which is giving me that, I don't know why. Okay, so if you take G tends to G plus beta G, then your Lagrangian basically changes also by this. This is for the general theory. This is nothing to do with the angle. This is like in general. So once you have this, then you can always calculate your stress energy tensor, which is mu nu, by using the formula. In four dimension, for example, it is given by this. So at quantum levels, when you try to solve this for a theory, you have theta mu nu is equal to beta g by g. Yeah. So now you can see where your connection is coming with your stress energy tensor with the beta function. Basically, in your classical theory, what you really do is your T mu nu is basically some field. So sorry, this is chi minus G mu nu L, right? This is for the classical, but quantum mechanically, then you have to consider something. Sorry, what happened? Yeah, this. It's fine?
Yeah.
Thank you. Can I ask a question?
Sure.
So CFT in three dimensions have finite number of generators, right?
Yes.
So when you consider Carolian limit of this CFTs, they'll also have finite number of generators?
They will have the finite, but it is infinite dimensional also.
What do you mean that it's infinite dimensional?
So infinite dimensional, I mean that you have the infinite number of generators in the CCL. So it is not finite.
Okay. But the CFT is finite. CFT has finite number of generators, but...
But the limit if you take, so there is a trick basically. So you have the finite number and then you extend the algebra to the infinite number of generators.
Okay.
Yeah. Let's move forward. Any more questions or should I move forward? All right, then I will then move to the next section, which is the large and limit of gauge theories. Okay. And Yang-Mills gauge theory can be simplified in the limit where the number of colors n is large. So the large n expansion has proved to be useful for the given reasons. So one of them, it is a systematic expansion and it simplifies the perturbation computation. And some of the QCD models in the two dimensional become solvable in this large n limit. So by large n limit, n is basically when you have, you know, in the QCD, you have n equal to 1, 2, and 3. Basically for the other Yang-Mills, for example, for SUN, you have n square minus 1, number of colors, or the number of, like where you have a mu a given by this. Yeah, so here your a is n square minus 1. So okay. Oh no, sorry. Yeah. So let us discuss the large N expansion for an UN gauge theory. So where your Lagrangian is basically given by trace of F square mu nu plus L matter. So matter can be any fermionic, scalar, or anything. You want to, like, basically it's fermion and scalars. So there is a convenient pictorial representation of Feynman graph in terms of the double line notation, which is given by this diagram. So Qi is the quark which is in the fundamental representation, and the Qj with a bar is the anti-quark which is in the anti-fundamental representation, and you have then the gluons which is in the adjoint representation, which is given Ai and J bar, where Ai and I bar is 1 to n. So Ai, J bar are basically Hermitian matrices. So we shall use a Feynman graph notation where oriented lines are associated with indices I and J bar and not with the fields. In this way, the propagator for an adjoint field can be naturally written as a double line. So the Feynman rules follow straightforwardly from the Lagrangian and can be easily understood by looking at explicit examples. So for that, let us first consider the case of the self-energy of the gluons, which is pictured below. And the indices at the beginning and the end of the line, where it is, this one, as you can see, has been identified. Since the kinetic term in the Lagrangian is diagonal on each component of Qi and Ai J bar, we see that the only free index is the internal one S, because each is done, so which may take n different values. So the self energy diverges as On. So many other graphs diverges, and this is only one graph which is I'm showing you, but there are other graphs also, because even the self energy of the gluons have many graphs, but this is one of them. So many other graphs diverges as well. It seems that n tends to infinity is not a sensible limit. However, the self energy contains power of the coupling constant, and it is of order O to G square YM N. So if we take this something known as the T-Hooft limit, where this n tends to infinity limit, which we take, becomes sensible. So n tends to limit in infinity, if you take, your coupling constant goes to zero with x, which you take to be as a product of these two, g square by n, to be fixed. So the self energy remains finite. The same happens to all other graphs. We shall now see that the T-Hooft limit makes sense for the entire perturbative expansion. It is better to redefine fields and bring all the dependence of GM, the G in front of the Lagrangian. Now we will play a trick. We will play a trick where you bring all the G in front of the fields or in front of the Lagrangian, where you have equation 26. So if you do so, the Lagrangian then is given by 1 by g square trace of f mu nu plus all the matter fields. And then using 25, what you can do, you can just replace your g square. So it is n by x trace of the same thing. So the propagators now bring a factor of x by n, and all types of vertices a factor of n by x. Till now, any questions? Or it was fine. I think I went a little bit fast. please let me know. So then I can move forward. Okay. So moving forward. So let us first restrict to a theory with only adjoint fields. So two simple examples of the graphs contributing to the free energies are given below. So one is basically given by the planar graph and the other is the non-planar. So in the planar graph, it has the topology of a sphere and the non-planar graph has the topology of the torus. Every graph then can be drawn without intersecting lines on the Riemannian surface of Euler characteristic, which is given by this, where your 2 minus 2g, where your g is the genus, or in other terms, it is just the number of holes, and f is the number of faces of the graph, and v is the vertices, and e is the edges. Like, for example, if you try to calculate the Euler characteristics for the sphere, it should come out to be equal to 2. So we see from the example that graphs with different topology have different powers of n. So we can derive a general formula. So we see from the example that the graph with different topology have different powers of n. So we can then derive a general formula, taking into account that we have a factor of n by x for each e and v, edges and the vertices, and n for the faces. So if you do that, if you plug it into it, the n by x in this, the above one, So ultimately you get x v minus e, x to the power v minus e, n is f minus v plus e with the order of n 2 minus 2g. So we see that the T-roof expansion organizes the graph according to its topology.
Aditya, one question. So sure. You said in your last slide, when you said that say non-planar graphs have the topology of torus, so do you mean for any number of external states, or like here you have a summation over number of genus, so what other possible graphs can you have?
There are many, but I have only shown here just like the a small example of it.
Is it that all planar graphs will have the topology of sphere and all non-planar graphs will have the topology of torus, or there will be many more?
I think there can be many more, but I'm not sure actually.
There can be many more. Basically, any higher genus surface.
Yes.
You can get from this sort of thing, and also like since he's looking here at vacuum bubbles, right? Mm-hmm. There's no question of external states because he's looking at the partition function, right?
I see. Okay.
Yeah.
So other genus graphs will correspond to what? Non-planar, meaning other kind of non-planar configurations.
Yes.
There will. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, Aditya, maybe you can answer.
No. Sorry, you have told. No worries. I was going to say the same thing.
I think Anish has a comment. Anish, do you
want to... I just had a quick question. So this is this organization, is this true for, I mean, only for minimally coupled theories, or one can do some this for like different types of coupling as well?
I'm sorry, different coupling means? I didn't understand.
I'm saying like, so you if you have like the gauge field plus the matter, I mean, the coupling through to the gauge field is only through the covariant, the gauge covariant derivative.
Mm-hmm.
Can you have like some matter times F square or something like that, like phi F square or something like that? In such kind of coupling also, would you be able to do something like this?
You're talking about this D-Hofstra expansion or something? This one?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, similar arguments. Perhaps it might not be the same. I don't know. But
I don't think so. I'm not sure about that. But I think for this theory, you can do. But yeah, I don't know if people have tried to do for example, for the Yukawa theory, as for example, right?
Right.
I don't know if people have done this D-Hofstra limit or something, because you should have a gauge field at least, I think so.
No, I mean, I have the gauge field, but I'm saying instead of just the coupling through the gauge covariant derivative, I could have like phi times F square or something like that. I mean, I'm not.
Yeah, no, right, but I understand your question, but actually the thing is that I don't know about this thing.
Okay.
Yeah. Not sure because, yeah, about this thing.
Can I make a comment? So, whatever interaction you include, it should be means we want the theory to be gauge invariant, right? So you cannot include any random interaction.
No, he's saying you can add like an axion type this thing, right? Like phi times F square. That's a gauge invariant interaction.
Right? Oh, okay. Where you're saying the axion is not charged under the gauge field kind of thing.
Sorry, no, I don't understand. He's adding a gauge invariant interaction term. Mm-hmm. I think he's just asking what happens if I do that to this counting, right, Anish?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the simplest is if you just take the leading kinetic term and just square it, like you have like a higher derivative correction, for example, that is gauge invariant. Something like that. So you could do something similar for the matter gauge coupling also. I don't know the precise form, but I don't think it's not. Okay. I don't think it'll be too difficult to write down.
I want to make one comment about this. If maybe Akhil has a question, so if it's related to this, we can maybe have that first.
It's not related. It's something neither. Like I'm slightly confused about the formula for the Euler characteristic you showed. Like, is that correct or am I confused?
Is a wire
It shouldn't be V plus F minus E, or maybe up to an overall minus sign. Am I missing something?
There's an overall minus
sign.
No, but shouldn't be V plus F? Shouldn't be symmetric in V and F?
V plus F. No, but then you have, that is for the pi.
I see. This is some... I mean, it should be the same thing, right? Up to some integer addition.
Yeah, it is. It is the same thing up to the same. But then you have this genus also on the other side.
No, my question is, shouldn't V and F come with the same sign, because this thing should evaluate identically for the. Sorry for the echo. Like, this thing should evaluate identically for the dual graphs, right? So V and F should come symmetrically, I thought.
Okay. But yeah. I don't know.
I mean, someone who knows this can tell me, right? Like, I mean, you confirm that I'm confused.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Just a random question. Sorry to
interrupt. No. B and F have to be of the same sign, actually.
Okay.
Depending on, because
then I will see if it.
All these graphs, you can draw these graphs. There's a symmetry because this chi is a symmetry of this. I mean, this is topological invariant.
Okay.
You can go to any vertex, and vertex shrinking and vertex expanding is allowed in those kind of graphs. So that only you can manage if V and F comes with the same.
Then I think I have some mistake or something.
No, but that's fine. Right. Yeah, just a second. Yeah.
No worries. Thank you.
So, Akhil, does that answer the question?
That answers my question. So in meanwhile, can you also make a comment on passing in Anisha's question?
It's just
how the F square. So if you have phi F square coupling, like, it's just the interaction is what, like, mainly there will be planar limit thing from an F loop, right? An FF, mm-hmm.
which is like a single band of loop. So that's an order. And I mean, since we are like having time, we could like probably just write it up, and like it's probably easy to see. It's like any gauge boson loop in the calculation. So it's a phi lambda. So it will give a leading correction to phi phi interaction, just like the self energy term for any other fermion or something in the theory. It's an order and order and order and order and.
I can add to that. So the thing is that the fact of the success of the Tuft ansatz or the Tuft limit, right, is really sort of a combinatorial fact. So let's say we take just a trace F square, right, and we forget about all the dynamics, right? Then F is basically like an object that has two indices, so it's kind of we can write it we can write down the what I mean is that the gauge bosons, the AMU, right, we can think of that as having like two indices, right? So when you expand out trace F square and you forget about the dynamics, so you forget about all the derivatives, then you basically have a quadratic term, a cubic term, and a quartic term, right? And you can sort of draw an analogy with the matrix model stuff that Neetu was telling us about. And what you can see is that even if you have like other interaction terms, that that you will always have a kind of, there will be a large end dominance of planar graphs. So I'm just saying, because in the matrix model, no matter what the potential function is, right, you're always going to have a large end dominance of planar graphs. So I think that probably the same thing will work out here as well.
I see. Okay.
When you're saying that you want to include matter field, that's also fine. So because if you think about it, your F mu nu or anything, this gauge things have two indexes, which are like representations of, I mean, representation and conjugate representation indices. So if you have a matter field, that's fine. That will give you some boundaries in the demand, the surfaces that you are getting. So this relation 2 minus 2g will just be modified with some a plus b minus e plus some boundaries. That's all. If you include the matter fields and phi, if you include phi square f square, the Madhu the way said, you can look at it in that matrix model way what Neetu have said.
In a particular matrix model.
Not necessarily. I mean, since that was what Neetu has done, that's why I said matrix model way. But as Madhu has pointed out, this has nothing to do with anything. This has everything to do with permutations, how two indexes are syncing and one another, right? So if you think about something like a trace of F square is nothing but, let's say, F is mu one, nu one, then nu one, mu one, right? And some mu two, mu one kind of thing. I mean, last two indices have to be same and all those things. So in that way, it just comes. It's just a permutation thing. It's nothing to do with anything else.
I see.
Okay.
So it can be done for any kind of combinations.
In principle, yes, I think so. I mean, at least for if you just include, let's say, you want to include matter fields, some psi field or something, anything like psi will come with one single index, right? So in these things, if you think about it, this your propagators have two indices now, if you only have gauge fields. So if you include psi, then you will get some one index kind of things. Which are also having some propagator. So that will be just like a boundary of this, whatever sheets or whatever diagrams you are drawing. That will just add on to boundaries. That's all.
Also, can I make a comment? Like, I guess like this is true for like any theory where there is a tensor field where the tensor indices run over large n factors, right? We know it works, this large n kind of and planar diagram dominance and all happens in all kind of tensor theories and even SYK and so on. So I guess you can always find a tuning of the coupling such that there's a planar dominance.
Yeah,
it's more general than just gauge theory, and they can probably motivated by the matrix theory algorithm. I mean, more than matrices, right? General tensor theories.
Yeah, but in the case of the tensor theories, is it known that the subleading guys are organized by some analog of genus or something? I don't think so, right?
That I really don't know. And it's also confusing, right? Because this band kind of picture probably is confusing when you have a higher indexed object, right? I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah, maybe this is something we'll look up and discuss on the Slack.
Yeah. Anymore? So, or should we? Sorry. Yeah. So basically, what this T-hooked expansion organizes the graph according to its to their topology. So now the expansion of the free energy in powers of 1 by n, in particularly, simply can be written as like this in equation 28, where your f, basically is your free energy, is the sum of g goes to 0 to infinity, n 2 minus 2g, some function fg of x. So one, that the planar graph gives the contribution of the order of of the order of n square to the free energy, which seems to diverge, as you can see from 28. So however, this is of the same order of the Lagrangian itself, evaluated on the generic configuration. So as if you take the Lagrangian, basically it is 1 by g trace of f square, which is equal to n by x trace of f square, and it is also of the order of n square. So leading term in the F correctly reproduce the behavior of the Lagrangian. The sub leading terms are basically suppressed in it. So till now, what we have seen for the largest expansion is that considerably what it does, it simplifies the perturbation theory. So for n greater than infinity, for goes to infinity, I'm sorry, not greater than, only the planar graph survives. This has been used to solve some 2D models in the planar image. Yeah. Now I'm complete. Now if you have, we can have more discussions. So from tomorrow, because this is a new topic and it will take a bit time for the ADS CFT. So I think it's better to start it tomorrow on this and then move on to the BMS, basically the gravity side of the flat holography. And then try to see the field theory side, which is your first try to explain the algebra, which is your GCA or GCA Galilean conformal algebra and the Carolean conformal algebra. Once we have that in hand, then in finally we will have some comparison between the physical thing, the observables which we have in the both theories. And if I have some time left, I think I will have. So I will then move on to the higher Carolean conformal field theories. Basically for field theories in D equal to 4 case, where I have done like try to find the field theories for with this limit and then try to see if this field theories which we get have the symmetry or not. And in the recent papers by some people, they are also trying to reproduce the correlation function which we have found in these theories and try to find it from the bulk side also. And there is all other thing about the BMS bootstrap, which I don't think so I will be discussing, but that is also something there. So this is the whole thing. Yeah. Please. More questions or if, yeah. So I'm done. No questions. Okay.
Argo and Akhil, you guys have questions or just forgot to load?
Sorry, forgot.
So till now, what we have done is that I have given you a bit introduction about the flat squares thing, why we are basically interested in that. Like for example, why we are interested in BMS. And we say it's a link to the black hole physics and all and everything, BTC black holes and all, entanglement entropy and all, we can calculate in that. And then give a small review about the conformal field theory, basically the conformal algebra and the quantum, basically a bit of the quantum thing for the conformal thing, like where you have the supersymmetric case. The only example which have the conformal symmetry at the quantum level is the n equal to 4 supersymmetric angles, which you already have seen, where your beta function is comes out to be equal to 0. If beta function is not 0, then you don't have the scale, and you have the scale anomaly basically there. And then we have moved on to the what is basically few on the gravity side, which is the ADS, which we have studied and have seen what is the coordinates. There are many other different type of coordinates where you can define the ADS, but I have only shown for the global and the Poincaré part because that will be useful in the later lectures. Yeah.
So I actually wanted to ask this once you actually showed how you take this limit from ADS to flat space, but because we have time and I thought I'll just ask this question. So I don't know how you are going to take. So presumably you're taking a lambda going to zero limit somewhere, or what type of limit is the thing that you will take from going from ADS to flat space?
Okay, to BMS. All right. If I can show you, yeah, we have time. Sorry, I'm just seeing where it is. Basically, you take the radius of the ADS to infinity. So
I see.
Basically, yeah. So what you do is take this, for example, here. You take the radius, which is here, it is L. Basically, it is the R. So it is when you take this to the infinity, then you reach the BMS. But this is so, yeah. Sorry.
Yeah. Okay. I see. Is there a way to like take this limit further that you go from, so instead of going from just stopping at lambda equal to zero, is there a way to go to lambda equal to positive and then say something about like, it's very speculative. So I'm just asking, is there a possibility to like talk about DSCFT that way?
The DSCFT, I don't think so, because this is for the ADS. Yeah. But there are people have worked on the DSCFT also, but I think that is bit different.
Right. I mean, that's why I don't think there is any, I don't know if there's a concrete understanding of DSCFT, but I just wanted to ask because you seem to have this some limit process where you get something good in the flat space case. I was thinking whether that procedure can be pushed to go to positive lambda. Is that possible?
I think people have tried for the DSCFT, the similar thing, but I don't think so. They have gone through like if this limit works there also, because then you have the positive lambda and then it changes the topology and everything, right?
Right. Maybe it'll be clear if once I understand what this limit actually is.
Akhil has a question.
Hi, I have a follow-up. I kind of missed this when you did this during the talk. So in the previous slide you were showing to Anish, what's the intuition that you take L tends to infinity and you get the boundary algebra? How do you say it?
This one?
Yeah. If I take L to infinity, why does
you don't directly take L to infinity. You have to first take some, you have to do some algebra basically. You basically take it at the level of the algebra here. So you take 46, for example, your ADS. This is for the ADS 3. That is the simplest example. So So then you have the killing vectors for this metric. So you have to directly taking L tends to infinity will just blow up everything. So you don't do that. So you have to be a little bit of, first you have to do something and then you have to take the L tends to infinity. So it's not a direct limit.
Yeah, but even then, like intuitively, what am I doing when I take this limit and how do I get the boundary algebra? Like
basically, L tends to infinity or something, what you are doing, you are reaching at the, you know, you have the ADS and you are going to the flat space limit. If you do that. I'm sorry, I think I didn't explain that well.
Like I think maybe if I can comment,
sure.
lambda is like 1 over L roughly. So I think L going to infinity is the lambda going to zero limit. So I guess is that enough?
Is that enough?
Are you guys saying this goes to the algebra of the flat space in the same dimension or the it's some boundary symmetry of the ADS? I thought we are saying this gives a boundary symmetry algebra or something.
No, this doesn't give the boundary. The boundary comes when you take R tends to infinity.
Oh, I thought in the previous slide you wrote boundary. Sorry, I was missing. Yeah.
That is near the boundary. Sorry, yeah.
Ah, okay. Thank you.
Yes, I'm a bit confused. So when you go to the boundary of the ADS, what you get? The flat space. Or flat the space. Boundary of the flat space. Because BMS is supposed to be at the boundary of the flat space, right?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So merely taking the flat space limit to the ADS, will you get the BMS algebra? I mean, don't you have to take the boundary of the flat space? Because the null infinity structure in the causal diagram that lies in the boundary of the Minkowski space, right?
Yes. Okay. But the thing is that I just wanted to tell you that the generators at 54. These are not the generators of the Carolian conformal. These are not the Carolian conformal generators. They are only equivalent to each other when you take R tends to something. Yeah.
So is the general philosophy like that? Let's say you have a flat space, and then you foliate the flat space by hyperbolic slices. So each slice is like ADS slices, and when you go to the edge of those hyperbolic slices, you go to the null infinity. So in this case, you are basically embedding the ADS in the flat space, in higher dimensional flat space, and then you are going to the boundary of that hyperbolic slices by taking this L going to infinity, where that actually touches the null infinity or the conformal sphere in higher dimension. And that will probably produce a BMS algebra, right?
That is one way to understand that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but we will see when we will discuss BMS more.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. Which I think will be, as the pace I'm going, it will be on the next, tomorrow's lecture. Okay. Any more questions or? Yeah, the formula for the Euler characteristic, I have to see. I think I made a mistake or something that I have to check. So minus something.
Hi, like since we have some time, like can I ask a naive question that like
Yeah, sure.
Do you guys know like a like a mathematical or like more like a simple graph theoretical argument why like this general kind of stuff, general kind of diagrammatics should have a large and limit if you just scale all these vertices, faces, edges and all in a particular way. Like,
sorry, can you repeat again?
So, like, so this is in follow-up to the previous discussion we were having about large and limits.
Okay.
So is there a simpler, so how do you like, is there a cute/cool way to kind of intuitively motivate that there should be a large and limit? Generally, like say even for, even, let's just talk about metrics kind of fields.
And, okay.
How do you see that? Like, I mean, I guess one way with hindsight you can say, so look, string theory, there should be some genus expansion and so on. But otherwise, just from the graph theory side, like, do you see, do you guys know a cute, cool way to say that there should be some scaling such that some expansion like this comes up?
From the graph theory.
Yeah, just like some combinatorial argument that like if you, I mean, so what I'm asking is this, like in different theories, the way you have to, the tooth limit is slightly different, right? Like you have to scale the coupling in a particular way.
Yes. Yes.
And I mean, it's always not G square N or something. It's sometimes it's N square and so on, right? So I'm just is there a more mathematical reason why when you have so many things, it should always afford a limit like this?
Like, I'm not an expert in this, but I think if people knows about this can explain you more, because this thing I don't know about. Try to expand that. Yeah. No, I don't know about that. Sorry, this thing. But yeah, I will think about this, and then if I have, then I think next lecture I will try to tell you about this if I come up with an answer about that. It's a nice question. It's. But yes, right now I don't have the answer to that. Any more questions?
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah. So, Miss, my question is very simple. Miss, I don't know anything about this flat space holography. So, in ADS safety, we know, means we have a gravitational theory in ADS space in bulk. Okay. And hello.
Yeah, sure, please.
So in the bulk we have a gravitational theory in ADS space, and in the boundary you have a conformal theory. So in flat space holography, it means how can we relate this bulk boundary? Is there anything like that?
The bulk boundary, that is the thing we will do with the BMS and CCA or the GCA, the Galilean part or the Carolian part of the conformal algebra with the flat space thing, which is the BMS for the ADS. Mm.
Okay, so here the space is asymptotically flat.
Yeah.
Okay, and that is in the bulk.
That is in the bulk.
Okay, and the symmetries, how what about the symmetries of the two?
We will see.
Okay.
Yeah.
If I may add a comment.
Sure.
Yeah. It's a very similar thing, but I think we don't still have a duality between theories yet. I think it's just a mapping of symmetries on both sides. Like even before ADS CFT happened, there was a mapping of asymptotic symmetries in ADS to global symmetries on the boundary. So that was the first step that led to sort of ADS CFT. So we want something similar, I think, in the asymptotic flat case also. And in asymptotically flat spacetime, the asymptotic symmetric group is not Poincaré, but it's actually this BMS group. And the boundary is, so we with the I don't think we so you want to have what are the global symmetries corresponding to these BMS symmetries on the boundary. I think that is the setup that we are currently in. Is this a correct way to describe it?
I think so, yes. Yeah.
So maybe another naive question, like so did you say the analog of BMS group for the ADS is Carolian group, or is that what you
no
said?
No, I told that for the CFT side
hello?
Is Carolian. Hello?
Yeah. Yeah, can you please repeat? I have lost my connection.
Sorry, I was making a comment saying that in before ADS CFT came out, there was a matching of symmetries, the asymptotic symmetry of ADS spacetime to the global symmetries of the boundary theory. So we want to, I mean, even that is not entirely established in asymptotically flat spacetime. So this BMS and this Carolian conformal algebra this connection is basically at that step. Like you want the asymptotic symmetries of asymptotically flat spacetime. Is actually not Poincaré, but it is this infinite dimensional group called the BMS symmetries. It's similar to Virasoro in ADS3, for example. So, and the corresponding boundary symmetries is this Carolian conformal algebra, like the whatever the CFT. I mean, I think right now it's conjectured to be some celestial CFT or something, I think, but we are at that step. And this is the context what Alja is talking about.
Okay, okay. Maybe in the next lectures I'll be more clear. Okay, thank
you. Yeah, yeah. What were you saying, Aditya? Like,
oh yeah. So I was saying is like for the so the Carolian conformal algebra is basically related to the boundary side, which is the CFT. And the BMS is related to the ADS side.
No, I was trying to understand this, like in this sense, like naively, like in the flats. I was just trying to motivate myself with some intuition like that, which maybe I'll say it and you can tell me if that makes sense, or if that's the correct way to think about it. So naively in the flat space, if you take a boundary limit, there is some null surface.
Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of like the way some null part massless particle will move about.
Mm-hmm.
And then the symmetry algebra relevant there is this BMS of that appropriate
dimension. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
But then you're kind of motivating that if you take the I was imagining that the C tends to zero limit is like kind of a limit where the null trajectory becomes time like. Does that make sense? And then hence you get a Carolian symmetry or something. Is that borderline or ballpark correct way to think about any of the statements, or am I completely misunderstanding what you said?
No, I think so. It's okay. Thanks. Yeah. But yeah, I think for like to have a full proper more discussion, I think it's better to like just first go to like what is BMS and all. And I think then okay. It will be much more clear.
Much more clear.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Yes. So yeah, from my side, it's like tomorrow I will discuss the ADS CFT and then move forward. Now. What should I do? Should I like disconnect this or I don't, sorry.
Yes. Maybe we can stop the recording and
sure.